the terminal characteristics of PN junction diode. So before we do the problem, we have discussed at length the forward bias characteristics. We have also discussed from the PN junction point of view the reverse bias characteristic and the breakdown, and in detail. Actually, just a quick recap of those things are in place here. So if you look at this current voltage characteristic, so I am now focusing only on the reverse bias side. So by reverse bias, I mean a diode with the P region connected to the negative and the N region connected to the positive. So this, okay, this positive and this negative. So if these, then we can say the circuit is under reverse bias, in which case we already know that the barrier potential as well as the width of the depletion region, everything will increase. Therefore, diode does not conduct . Then why do we have this? So as I told you, there is actually, even though the diode simply does not conduct in the usual sense with the majority carrier, the minority carriers do contribute to what is known as the leakage effects, and the leakage effects will, which means we have discussed this, okay, leakage effects. I am just recollecting your memory. Leakage effects is due to minority carriers on either side of the junction. So the minority carrier in P region is the electrons, and the minority carrier in the N region is the holes. So normally you don't expect, so because the barrier is, the depletion width increases to a great extent under reverse bias, which means this is my depletion width. You don't expect the carriers to cross over the junction, but the electric field is so strong that the field is going to be there. So here you have like the donor ion, which is, and this region is devoid of any mobile charges. Remember that. So the minority carrier here, electrons will cross through this thing under the influence of this field, and the field is so strong that it allows leakage effects to happen, and the current due to this leakage effects is what is known as the reverse current. Mathematically speaking, we had derived this relationship at that time. I had told you, all you need to do is reverse the sign of the applied voltage, then you will get the reverse characteristics, which means here V stands for the applied voltage across the diode. Now, if I reverse the sign of this applied voltage, then if for the case of reverse bias, if the magnitude of V is a few times larger than Vt, which is the thermal voltage, then this is an exponential decay function, which means this term diminishes because of this negative sign, in which case I, which is the reverse current I, will more or less becomes minus Is. Okay, now Is is the saturation or scaling current. Okay, and we had explained the terminologies also, so I am not going to go back and do that again. You have to recollect from there. So Is is a saturation current, and that saturation current we are talking about is actually over here. It saturates for up to certain voltage. Okay, that is the up to the voltage what is known as VZK, which is the Zener knee voltage. Up to that voltage, it is like a saturation behavior, and this I reverse current, think about this. Normally Is is of the order of only 10 power minus 12 to 10 power minus 18 amperes. Normally this is the order depending on the doping levels. Now the reverse current, practical diode, what we see is this reverse current is actually of the order of, it can be from microampere to nanoampere, microampere to nanoampere. This reverse current is also function of temperature. And think about this, here it is 10 power minus 12 to minus 18, here minus, and I have neglected this factor. Now we are getting practical real diode, we are getting this microampere to nanoampere. So how do I explain? The explanation comes from the generation of large amount of when you see the intrinsic carrier concentration increases. When you increase the intrinsic carrier concentration for a doping level at a temperature, you are going to increase the minority carrier. Okay, so the minority carrier is actually the, I will put it this way, you are increasing the Ni is actually is there. Ni square is N0 P0. Okay, this, if I remove this naught, then this is under the bias NP. Now what I want you to think about this is here, this equation, when you increase the temperature, the minor, there are lot of carriers which are being generated as a result of the temperature, and those carriers will contribute to leakage effects. Therefore the leakage current will dominate over this saturation current. Therefore you will get in terms of microampere to nanoampere. Okay, so the leakage effects come into play. Okay, that enables the minority electron from P to crossover across the depletion region, and the minority holes from N region to crossover to constituting a reverse current of this order. Now if you look at germanium and silicon, germanium, this control is actually in the order of microampere. Okay, whereas with silicon it is of the order of nanoampere. Okay, so mainly if you are to look at it here, you will see that it is not going to because of this fact. Okay, because of this fact we are having the silicon being used much more as often, because the thermal stability with the silicon based devices is better. We have a control. That is the idea, and this I expressed in the very first class, that we need that control over the carrier generation and the current, so that reliability in the device operation can be met. That is the main thing. Therefore, silicon is preferred over germanium. Okay. So that is about this reverse side. Now, what about the behavior? We have discussed the breakdown region. Even for a very small voltage increase across the diode, the current, the reverse current runs, okay, and goes very high without damaging the diode. Okay, the minimization, just because the current runs very high, that doesn't mean that the diode is damaged. You can keep reusing the diode without damaging the diode by suitable control of the external circuit, like using a current limiting resistor, so that you are able to operate the diode within the power rating specified for that particular diode. Okay, this also we have emphasized earlier. Now, I think I have said enough on this, so let us move on. Okay, now I just only want you to tell you this one fact, which I did not say, is that, let me tell that over here, I will write it, that IS, okay, remember this, saturation current IS doubles for every 5 degree increase in temperature. It doubles. It becomes twice. On the other hand, as I told you, the reverse current I doubles for every 10 degree centigrade increase in temperature. So this is like a rule of thumb, which means it's a thumb rule. When you use a diode under reverse bias, you can keep these aspects in mind, so that if thermal effects come into play, then we can find out where the current is increasing, why it is increasing with the thermal effect based on this. Or on the other hand, it reduces, then we can say due to cooling, okay, lowering of temperature. So keep that aspect in mind. Okay. Now, remember, Ni is material property, intrinsic carrier concentration. But what you need to understand is, when we talk about carriers for current flow, we need the carriers to move. Okay, the ability to move of the charge carrier is what is constituting the current. So keep that in mind. So just because Ni is there, that doesn't mean that a material, semiconductor material, has conductivity. You have to have the carriers available, electrons in the conduction band, holes in the valence band, for them to conduct. Okay. So never forget that fundamental. Now take this problem. Okay. So we'll do this problem. This is a very signature problem, very important problem. So we want to do this problem because some of you are not having the book, and I am obliged and compelled to read this problem for your this thing. So here the question is, assuming this is a very signature problem, assuming the diodes to be ideal, this method that what we study here, this method will be very useful even with the transistors. So please pay attention, find the values of I and V in the circuit. So here I is there, this current is asking for, and V is this voltage, this voltage. There are two figures given. Let us take one figure at a time and try to do it. So this the I will blow the image so that you are able to clearly see, and I will also come to the full screen mode. So hopefully you should be able to see it now. So this is the picture. In this case, it is very very difficult. I mean, this is some, not I will say this circuit we have only two diodes. Probably with some intuition you can actually say which diode will be conducting, which will not be conducting. In this kind of problem, some kind of starting assumption we have to keep, and then we have to get answers. So here the current directions are given. We have to do node analysis. We may have to do sometimes KVL analysis. Node is the KCL, node equation. Okay, current. The incoming current is equal to outgoing current. But in the case of sometimes with the loop, we may have to do KVL also. So what I suggest is, to begin with this kind of problem, you have to assume with something. That assumption has to do with this, the element, that is the diode, whether the diode are conducting or the diode is not conducting. Okay, so that has to be seen, because you see here there is a plus 10 volt, there is a minus 10 volt. So you obviously, and here it is grounded, here it is grounded. So you obviously do not know how to go about this. So we start with assumption and we try to work out some, look at the consistency in our analysis. If our results are consistent, then our starting assumption is correct. It is like akin to saying some kind of a mathematical induction stuff. You prove the equation right hand side, left hand side equal to n equal to 1. And then you say, assuming it is true for n equal to k, then you prove it for n equal to k plus 1. That is how we do in the mathematical induction. Here, some assumption, we start with some solid assumption, some assumption based on our intention, intuition. Then I am talking about the methodology of doing. After that, I will do the problem. We start with some assumption, then do the analysis, get the values of current, check its consistency with the direction, check its consistency. Consistency, okay, whether it is actually true or not, that is what it is meaning. So let us assume both diodes are conducting. Let us assume that. Okay, so if you look at this picture, you see there is a minus 10 volt here. There is a 5 kilo ohm. It is connected to the power is connected to there. On the top, you got the plus 10 volt connected to the 10 kilo ohm. There is a current that flows through here. The diode is here. So we are assuming both diodes are conducting, which means we are assuming they both are under forward bias. Both are under forward bias. forward bias, which means we can actually redraw this circuit. Okay, so let us redraw the circuit. Then what do we get? Because both are forward bias, under forward bias when we are assuming, which means for an ideal diode, this is shorted, this is shorted. So what do we get here? We will get like this. Point B, which is directly grounded, and here again, this is, you have this picture, and I am measuring with respect to ground. Okay, but B is grounded, and this is shorted. Then I have a 10 volt, so there is a resistor, 10 kilo ohm. Then that goes to 10 plus 10 volt, and here in this side you have a resistor, and it goes to minus 10 volt. Now you look at this picture. This is V. If B is grounded, which means the potential at the point VB is zero, and then this point over here, because this all shorted, so this point, so V also must be zero. This is based on our assumption. Are they true? Is it true? That's what we have to see. Okay, so VB is zero, V is zero because of this. So what I have drawn, because we have considered ideal diode, which means practically it is shorting, potential drop for ideal diode VD is zero. Shorting, simple short. Okay, so VB must be zero, V must be zero. So now let us look at this picture. So I will again take this drawing. Again draw this, and then if I need, I can delete it. So what I have, the equivalence of the circuit is clearly seen in this manner. Point B, VB is zero. So I'll redraw this to do the analysis carefully, because you people are beginners, so I can do it in one go. You have to learn that art. Ten volt plus 10 volt. This is minus 10 volt. So whatever current, okay, this is minus 10 volt. Whatever current that is going to go through, this is VB equal to zero. So, okay, so this 10 volt is there. This is 10 kilo ohm. Okay, so there is a how to do this current. So this ID2, what about the value of I? We have to see that, right? Because that is VB zero, okay, and ID2 is there, and here it is there. So what I will put is, actually you will see that ID2 is, so this is my current I, and here it is grounded. The potential may be zero, you have to be careful. So this is grounded. Okay, so here there is some current coming, there is a node here. So we have to write this node equation. To write that node equation, first we need to find what is ID2. ID2 can be found because this is VB zero, so this point is zero, which means ID2 will be equivalent to 10 minus zero divided by 10 kilo ohm, which means 1 milliampere is the current that is coming, Id2 equal to 1 milliampere. That is coming. Now, we are having a, this is grounded, but this diode is there. It is shorted, the diode is there, and it is grounded, and this is zero. Okay, so you might, what is the value of I? So we have to see that. So here, there is a current, I is here. So there is 1 milliampere, and this is I. Okay, and here I want to find what is the current I. That's the idea. This current I need to find. So I plus 1, I plus 1. Why 1? Because Id2 is 1. This is incoming current. Now this potential is there. There will be a current through this resistor. Let us say this current is I3, because I have kept D2. So I3 is the current through this 5 kilo ohm resistor. So we know this potential at this point is zero, which means the current I3 will be equivalent to, so this is my outgoing current, this is my incoming current for this node B. There is also an incoming current here. Both the diodes are conducting. Okay, so you have to understand that. You might wonder, if I short it, this is zero. Sir, this is zero, why there is thing? See, this is only to analyze with ideal diode. Think about that. We have a zero potential drop. For that we are keeping. And secondly, we have minus 10, there is something, there is an arm, there is a connection. Shorting means there is a wire that is been going. Okay, a copper wire being grounded. Think like that. So the current can go through that. So there is, in this case, what we have started with, the current is coming into the node B. Therefore, this I plus this current, which is Id2, equivalent to I3. What is I3 value? What is I3? So I plus 1 equal to, this is 0, this is at a higher thing, this is minus. So it becomes actually 0 minus of minus 10 divided by 5 kilo ohm, which is 10 power 3 ohms. So what will we get here? We will get 10 divided by 5 by 10 power 3, that becomes 2 milliampere. 2 into 10 power minus 3 ampere. And I, we know that I is equivalent to I plus 1 equal to, I plus 1 equal to, I plus 1 equal to 2 milliampere. So we'll keep it as milliampere, and I equal to therefore 1 milliampere. Right? So if I equal to 1 milliampere, Id2 equal to, we got already 1 milliampere. And here we get 2 milliampere, which means we clearly see that at the node B, we clearly note I equal to 1 milliampere, which is incoming, Id2 equal to 1 milliampere, which is incoming, I3, which is outgoing, is 2 milliampere. So this is exactly the kind of consistency, because there is no charge accumulation anywhere. Okay, and which means everything is, whatever is incoming, the fundamental KCL node equation is fulfilled without any problem, without any ambiguity, which means our starting assumption is consistent. That's the idea. Now let us go to the other result. And what is the voltage V? That is another answer. So the answer, I equal to 1 milliampere, V equal to 0, because this is shorted, the potential at B is 0, so this point must be 0. So V is 0, I equal to 1 milliampere. These are the answer. Now let us go to the other figure. We will do similar analysis with this and then we will find out what do we get, what do we have in us. So here is the picture for this. So this is my another stuff. So in this case, again, see, if you look at this two figures carefully, you see the difference. This is 5 kilo ohm, this is 10 kilo ohm. The power supplies are same, but the resistances have been either halved in the upper one or doubled in the lower arm. So the resistance or in other words, you can say the resistance have been interchanged. Okay, then what happens? Then will the diode, both the diodes. So in case of the figure A, both the diodes are conducting fine. Okay, in case we have proved that both diodes are conducting in case of, and our this was our assumption and our results are consistent, so this is correct. But what about this? Are both diodes conducting? We will start with both of them conducting, then what do we see? Starting with assumption, some kind of, when you do electronic circuit analysis, some kind of reverse engineering, intuition, it will come with some experience. All these things are required. Starting with assumption of both the diodes being conducting. More practice is required. When I write, you may get it. You have to do it on a piece of paper and try to understand. Then what do we see here again? I can draw the equivalent circuit. First thing, I have to do that. This is my 5 kilo ohm. This is my plus 10 volt. This is my minus 10 volt. So this is plus 5 kilo ohm. This is 10 kilo ohm. Again, this is shorted, and here we have drawn this current I, and here the current is ID2. Okay. And here let us say same I3. Let us use the same thing and find out whether there is consistency. So you can clearly see VB is 0. So this fellow will be 0. So in this case, ID2 will be equivalent to 10 divided by 5. It will become 2 milliampere. ID2 is 2 milliampere. Okay. What about the I3? I3 will be equivalent to, this is 0. So it becomes 10 divided by 10 kilo ohm. I3 will become 1 milliampere. Now for this loop at the node equation at B, node equation at B is, node equation at B is actually, you will see I plus 2 milliampere incoming equivalent to here. What is the thing? You get 2 milliampere. ID2, 2 milliampere, which is this. This is 1 milliampere. 1 milliampere, sir. I3, I plus 2 equal to I3. Outgoing current. So ID2 is actually, so let me write the equation ID2. So this is my incoming ID2. So what do you get? I equal to minus 1 milliampere, which means, you see, I have taken the diode to be forward bias, but the current, it is inverted, which means my assumption, starting assumption, that this is conducting is not correct. It clearly tell you I is incoming, okay, positive to negative, but definitely the way the connection, where the answer is coming out, for consistency you must get one minus 1 milliampere. So which means this diode D1 must have been reverse biased with respect to this potential and with respect to this ground, which means the negative must be okay. So my answer is not correct. So how do I solve this problem? That is the idea. Okay, so we have to think along the direction. So what we will do is, now we start all over again. So I will take my picture back again, and again, because every time I have to bring that, so that we don't make a mess with it. So here, my first assumption was both the diodes conducting, but the answer I equal to minus 1 clearly tells me that this is not possible for a forward bias. Not possible for forward bias. Not possible for forward bias of diode 1. So which means, implies starting assumption is incorrect. Starting assumption is incorrect. This is called the troubleshooting a circuit. Starting assumption is incorrect. This method will be very useful when you do the transistor analysis also. Okay, starting assumption is incorrect. So how do I proceed further? So now I will assume D1 is reverse bias, D2 is forward bias. So I am starting all over again. In this case, assumption D1 is reverse bias, D2 is forward bias, which means I will clearly tell you that I want to find, in which case, so how do I get this value? So I will see that, I will again redraw that stuff, equivalent circuit. So this is reverse bias. Our aim is to find this V and also this I. This is plus 10 volt. This is 5 kilo ohm. We cannot just skip the steps, otherwise we will be in trouble. So ID2 we have to find, because this is shorted, this diode, this D2 is forward bias. So which means the current here, it will be ID2. Okay, we need to find. How do I find this? For this to find, you see here, this is point B. Now this is no more, because earlier we thought this fellow is, this will have some potential, VP will have some value. VP is no more zero. In the earlier case, because it is here, it was shorted, so this potential at VP was zero, but now it is reverse bias, which means it is open. The potential at B is unaffected by what is happening here, it is rather affected by here. And this potential at this point will be the same as here. That potential is affected by how much current it flows through this 5 kV with respect to the 10 volt supply, and 10 volt minus IR, ID2 will be the potential at this point. Okay, so ID2 is coming like this. So how do I find ID2? That same current will be flowing through this. Okay, so ID2, to find ID2, what I will do is, I write the KVL. So 10 volt, so I start with the positive 10, and then minus 5 ID2, and then again, there is a potential drop here, at this point, minus 10 ID2. Okay, right now I have neglected that kilo ohm, but I will take that into later. Minus, this is minus 10 volt, so it is actually, it becomes minus of minus, because you are at a negative to here, it is you are at a positive. So when you are doing this kind of analysis, when you are landing up like this, you have to see that it goes as minus 10 equal to 0. Remember this, if you are in a circuit, if you are going from negative to positive, it is actually voltage rise. We are coming from positive to negative, which means you are at a positive to negative when you are coming, it is a voltage drop. So you have to put a negative over here. So therefore, that minus 10 is already there, that negative is here. So it becomes actually ID2 will be equivalent to 20 divided by 15 kilo ohm 10 power 3, that is equivalent to 1.33 milliampere. 4 by 3 will get, 4 by 3 is 1.33. So what will be the drop here? So that is the current. So what will be the voltage measured here? V will be equivalent to, I use this across here. This is the current that ID2 is going through, flow through. So I know what is ID2 here. So I will use that. So it becomes actually 10 minus 5 into ID2. You can do it the other way also, 1.33. So you will land up actually roughly about 3.3 volt. So V is 3.3, the current I, because it is reverse bias, I equal to 0. That makes sense, because we can get the, whatever values I'm getting, you can check it in this loop, you will get the same 3.3, because VB is 3.3, you substitute here. 10 minus, here 3.3 plus, this is minus. So you will get actually, check this, what will be the current, you will get 4 by 3 again. Because it will become 13.3 divided by 10, okay? So that becomes, actually you will get this, okay? The same current you will get, 13.3 divided by 10, you will get 1.33 milliampere. So it's consistent result. So D1 must be reverse bias, D2 must be forward bias. Okay, we'll do some more problem in tomorrow's class. That will be the syllabus. Okay, just a second. I did this problem very carefully slowly so that you understand. Actually, I wanted to do some more problems, but we are run short of time. We'll continue tomorrow to do more problems. Up to this topic, it is there. It is I will put it up in the AMS. Please go through that.